think about approaching Easter as well. Resurrection power is not just limited to Easter, but to each day. Would you pray with me? God, thanks for meeting us here today. Thanks for meeting us in the midst of all of our stuff. Because, God, we've all got stuff. We've all got things in our lives that frustrate and worry and hold us back, and even stuff we know is not right. And it's still there, and we still hold on to it. God, in the midst of our stuff, we're grateful you love us, and we pray that you will help us love you and not let that stuff hold us back. We ask it in Jesus' name. Amen. God is an encouraging God. When Joshua is getting ready to lead the people of Israel into the promised land, God says these words to him: "Have I not commanded you, be strong and courageous? Do not be afraid, do not be discouraged, for the Lord your God will be with you wherever you go." Throughout the Bible, God encourages us, and the main reason he encourages us is he says, "I'll be with you. You're not going to be alone. You're not going to go through the valley by yourself. You're not going to have to climb the mountain by yourself." He walks with us. He doesn't walk in front of us. He doesn't walk beside us and to just be a companion. He doesn't walk behind us to kick us. Well, sometimes he does, I think. He walks with us. Sometimes people ask me why they should read the Old Testament. It's old. it's back there. I don't understand so much of it. Why should we read the Old Testament? Listen to this. Romans 15:4. For everything that was written in the past was written to teach us, so that through endurance and the encouragement of the Scriptures, we might have hope. He's talking about the Old Testament. When the New Testament was being written, there wasn't a New Testament. It was only the other. This is why we should read. Because the stories are meant to encourage us. Have I not commanded you? Be strong and courageous. Do not be afraid. Do not be discouraged. For the Lord your God will be with you wherever you go. I love watching geese fly, preferably not from underneath them. I love watching them fly in that V shape and hearing the honking going on. I don't know, it's just something about it. And it reminds me of some of the lessons that we can learn from watching geese. Like research says that geese flying in that V formation are 71% more efficient. They fly 71% further than they would by themselves because of the lift coming off of the other birds, their companions. You know, don't try to go it alone. Always go with someone else. When the lead goose tires, it rotates into the back. Somebody else takes the lead. And that's important. Anybody who tries to be everything to everybody will end up being no good to anybody. It's a good reminder. And then there's their honking. Research says that the honking is encouragement. I don't know how they know this, but they're honking to say to the lead birds, keep up the speed, keep up the effort. We're doing great. Makes sense. Makes perfect sense. Productivity goes up in an environment that's encouraging. Joy and happiness increase when we hear words of encouragement. In fact, I would venture to bet joy and happiness increase in our lives when we're encouraging to others. God thinks encouragement is so important, he included it as one of the 21 spiritual gifts in the Scriptures. Romans 12. If your gift is serving, then serve. If it is teaching, then teach. If it is to encourage, then give encouragement. Now, just because encouragement is a spiritual gift doesn't mean you can say, well, I obviously don't have that gift, so I don't need to be encouraging. There are some people who are just gifted encouragers, just like there are gifted teachers, just like there are gifted serving people. Now, just because you don't have the spiritual gift of serving doesn't mean you get to, oh, I don't have to serve. No, we're all supposed to serve. Some people are just gifted in it. And some people are gifted encouragers. These are the people we love to be around. Here's what the Bible says about our words. Do not let any unwholesome talk come out of your mouths, but only what is helpful for building others up. Now listen to this, according to their needs. Oh, well, how do I know what their needs are? Unless I care and I listen. Encouragement is about somebody else, that it may benefit those who listen. You know another way to say this? If you can't say something nice, God knew this a long time ago. Not your mother. A most recent favorite way of saying this for me, let's be careful that in our hatred of hate, we're not hateful. Have you noticed that going on in our culture right now? People who hate those that are hateful toward others are hateful to that person. And I'm like, wait a minute. This is not right. Spewing hateful things about people who spew hateful things only creates two spewers of hate. The very thing you say you hate. God says, watch your words. Let your words be encouraging. 1 Thessalonians 5:11 says, therefore encourage one another and build each other up, just as in fact you are doing. I love it. He is encouraging them to be more encouraging. You're doing great. Keep it up. This is Paul's way of honking, if you will. Keep up the encouragement. So how do we be encouragers? What do? First of all, I would suggest we ask ourselves, what would Jesus say? What would Jesus say in a situation? Romans 15:5. May the God who gives endurance and encouragement give you the same attitude of mind toward each other that Christ Jesus had. What would Jesus say to that person, to yourself, to somebody else? How would Jesus say it? Remember, we can say the right thing in the wrong way and ruin the whole thing. What would Jesus say? How would Jesus say it? This is the kind of mind God wants us to have. He encourages us to think like Jesus. Now, how do we do that? Well, thankfully, when you invite Christ into your life and you have a personal relationship with Jesus, the Holy Spirit comes and resides in you and helps begin renewing your mind. We don't have to force the mind of Jesus to happen. But the scripture does say in one spot, take every thought captive to Jesus. So we are responsible for what we, being careful of our thoughts, how we're thinking. But the renewal of our mind, the renewal of our heart comes. is that a particular scream that you hear? Way to go, Mitch. And the renewal of our mind happens because of the presence of the Holy Spirit. So yes, we need to encourage ourselves to have the mind of Christ, and yet we have help. God doesn't say, have the mind of Christ, go figure it out on your own. He helps us. Now, here's the second thing. Find the most positive way to say it. When you have something to say, figure out how to say it positively. There are some people who, when there's a new thing, are negative, right from the start. They don't like it, they don't understand it, they don't whatever. Take a deep breath, be an encourager. You can even say it this way. That's a very interesting thought. It's kind of non-committal, right? Non-judgmental, if you will. Proverbs 15:1 says, a gentle answer turns away wrath, but a harsh word stirs up anger. Stephanie and I used to lead marriage retreats. We'd go on a Friday and with, I don't know, anywhere from eight to, did we have as many as 10 couples? Maybe something like that. So small, but had you know, 18, 20 people. And we'd go on a Friday and have all day Saturday and get up Sunday morning, have some worship, do some more teaching, and then come home kind of after lunch. And one of the things we would ask couples to do, we'd give projects throughout the time. You know, I'd do a teaching on stuff. Stephanie was the hospitality, and so after the teaching, here, go work on this project together. And one of them was a list of things, questions to ask each other. And we used this particular verse in some of those conversations. And the question we would ask was this. Do you practice the first part or the second part of this proverb? And what difference would it make in your relationship? Do I give gentle answers? Or am I typically more harsh? Makes a big difference. Because a gentle answer turns away. An interesting question you might want to ask your spouse if you're married. In marriage, God calls us to fight for each other, not against each other, except when hanging wallpaper. No. isn't it funny if you're married, isn't it funny how the littlest things can stir up great emotion and anger? Which way does the toilet paper roll? What do you do with the toothpaste tube?
You have your own.
You have your own. That's why they have bathrooms with two sinks. You know, we do. We get so involved in some things. Stephanie and I, we replaced the carpet in our master closet, 85 square feet or something like that. I found a great price on some wood floor. So I put the wood in. So we had to, you know, pull most of the clothes out to get to it. And so we're putting, well, let's rearrange it a little bit. Let's do this. And I don't know. I was asking something like, I have most of my pants hang over a hanger, not on the pant hangers where they're hanging long. And I said, I don't know, do you think I should put them on that? And she goes, it really doesn't matter. You know, and I'm like, but I really want your opinion. Well, if you hang them, you get this. And if you do them this way, you know, over there. And it was funny just how the emotion just kind of went up over something so simple. You were tired. It's no excuse. And how encouraging are we to one another? It's so easy to not be, because we are tired and the days are long and all of these other things that are happening in our world and in our lives. Proverbs 15:23, a person finds joy in giving an apt reply, and how good is a timely word. Probably a good year ago, Stephanie and I were checking out of the Kroger on 48, and we just had a few things, and in front of us was a dad with a couple of kids, and the checkout lady was just a sweet older lady. And the guy had apples in one of those bags. He had put 5 different apples in the same bag. Now, if you ever go grocery shopping for apples, this is a no-no. And not knowing that, the lady, you know, scanned the one and said, weighed him, and he went ballistic. I mean, he wasn't yelling loudly, but he certainly was not a good example, first of all. And he really was berating her and saying, there's five different ones. And she was getting flustered. And Stephanie and I are just feeling a little uncomfortable for her. And of course, I wanted to say something to the dad. So finally through a process, she gets it all taken care of, and he leaves. And you can tell she looks like she's on the verge of tears. And Stephanie and I almost at the same time looked at her and said, "It's okay. We're not in a hurry. Take a breath. It's all right." Just in that kind of a voice. And you could see her, kind of, how good is a timely word? We become greater encouragers when it's not about our schedule. Frankly, when it's not about us. It's about that other person. And what's that word that they need from us? We get to be Jesus at that point. People are more important, always. And when people are more important than all the other stuff going on in our world, our words tend to be more encouraging. A friend of mine, Tim Stevenson, who lives down in Dallas, says this way, "There's never enough encouragement in the world, and we have the ability to inspire people through this powerful force, or we can break them down through discouragement. What we say and how we say it will determine which it is." Paul writes in Philippians 2. Philippians was a book written while Paul was in jail in prison. "Is there any encouragement from belonging to Christ, any comfort from his love, any fellowship together in the Spirit? Are your hearts tender and compassionate? Then make me truly happy by agreeing wholeheartedly with each other, loving one another, and working together with one mind and purpose." Want to know how to be encouraging? Agreeing wholeheartedly, loving one another, working together. Here it is. Here's a third thing about being encouraging. Speak truthfully. Speak truthfully. Conflict is essential to innovation and creativity. You have to have it. You have to have conflict to really grow in a relationship. In a business team, for a business team to reach their peak performance, there must be conflict. They must have good, healthy conflict. Encouragement doesn't mean we should discourage conflict, but encourage it. Respectful, honest, non-judgmental conflict. It's a healthy thing. I'm having a conversation right now with a very close relative of mine who is figuring out life. And a couple of weeks ago, we sat down and I said, "Okay, I'd like to sit down, every couple of weeks with you and kind of walk through some of the things you're going through in life. And I'm going to say some things that you're not going to like. And I'm going to give you some suggestions that you're not going to agree with. But I want you to be able to look at me and say, I don't like that very much," and just with that voice. "And let's have a conversation about it." It's okay to disagree. It's okay to look at somebody and think, "That's a really dumb idea." And then look at them and say, "I don't agree with that. Could you help me understand what's behind that?" This is healthy conflict. Or just looking, "I don't want to do that." Okay. Let's figure it out. This is encouragement. Encouraging people aren't just people who automatically agree with everything. But they're encouraging even in healthy conflict. Recognition and encouragement energize people, whereas lack of recognition and discouragement, lack of recognition and lack of encouragement drains people of energy. How can you encourage? Fourth, speak redemptively Our words are called to be redemptive. 2 Corinthians 13:11. Finally, brothers and sisters, rejoice. Strive for full restoration. Encourage one another. Be of one mind. Live in peace. And the God of love and peace will be with you. A former colleague of mine and one of my dearest friends and accountability partners, Dr. Dan Francis, is finishing up a book, and he graciously gave me some pieces from it because he and I have talked about it for so many years. And the title is Stay in the Room Relationships. Think about the image. Stay in the Room Relationships. And his premise is that God desires all of our relationships to be redemptive whenever possible. Reconciliation is the goal. Forgiveness, as we learned last week, is not an option. It's automatic for a Christ follower. And this is his graphic for the premise that he's looked at. Reconciliation. Stay in the middle of the room, if you will. Seek that reconciliation. But problem is, we often go to one of these four corners. We go up to the hurts, and we nurse our hurts, and we rehearse our hurts. We coddle our hurts, and we don't let it go. We concentrate totally on the hurt. Or we're in the corner of fear. We go to a place where the fear could be so many different things, most of it unfounded. Well, if I say this, what are they going to think about me? Even happens in marriage, doesn't it? I have a thought, a desire, a need, whatever, and I don't want to say it because I'm not sure what their response will be. Doesn't matter how long, at least to my knowledge, it doesn't matter how long you've been married. We all have this, we go to this fear corner that's typically an unfounded fear. We go to the blame corner. We don't see our part in the relationship problem at all. It's all the other person's fault. Completely. Or we go to the vengeance corner. Don't get mad, get even. These are not helpful to healthy relationships. Stay in the middle. Stay in the room. Don't walk out. Be willing to go through the conflict and the struggle of talking through words. You know what we so often do in our relationships? I know what you're not saying. No, we don't. But that's where our minds go. I know what you didn't say. And we make these assumptions and we jump to these conclusions. Dr. Dan says, stay in the middle. Be committed to reconciliation in our relationships. This is healthy. This is good. Romans 12 says it this way. Do not repay anyone evil for evil. Be careful to do what is right in the eyes of everyone. If it is possible, as far as it depends on you, live at peace with everyone. Do not take revenge, my dear friends, but leave room for God's wrath. Kind of read in there. God knows how to get them back better than you do. It is mine to avenge. I will repay, says the Lord. On the contrary, if your enemy is hungry, feed him. If he is thirsty, give him something to drink. In doing this, you will heap burning coals on his head. Yes. Do not be overcome by evil, but overcome evil with good. Now, I love this passage, and I've known about this passage for, I don't know, I've been walking with the Lord for coming on 40 years. And so I've known about this a long time ago. I remember as I began to read this passage and live with this passage over these years, I thought, man, when I use good, when somebody else is being nasty to me, it's actually going to get them back and it's going to burn them. When I matured last year, I figured out that this probably was not the heart of God. There's something else going on here. In the first century, communities in that region of our world had a community fire. And people would come out of their homes, probably a designated person, and every day they would gather hot coals to take back to their home, to cook with, and to heat the home. And guess where they would normally carry the coals? On a basket or bowl on their head. And the image that Paul wants us to have is that when we repay evil with good, when we feed our enemy and clothe the one that is nasty to us, we're going to the fire ourselves, and we're helping them. And we're giving them that which will be good for their lives and bring them health and warmth. We're going to help them build up. Because anybody that's just nasty and mean and hurtful and hateful has got some things missing in their life. And Paul says, when we are Jesus to them, we're helping them stoke the fire. Isn't that a brilliant image? This is the power of encouragement. In today's world, we need encouraging words. We bring the healing power of God's Spirit into somebody's life because of the words we speak. We're helping them renew their lives because someone else's anger is not about you. It's something from them. When we don't take it personally, we're able to react with the heart of God. We all want the best in life, and we all want to expect the best from others. But high standards without encouragement only leads to discouragement. Hebrews 3:13 encourages us. But encourage one another daily, as long as it is called today, so that none of you may be hardened by sin's deceitfulness. Encouragement has the power to help make us holy, which is God's call on our lives. What's the most encouraging way you can say some things today? What's the most positive way you can say some things today? And I know sometimes we get into that really snarky mood. I'm positive that's a dumb idea. No, what's the positive way we can say it? What's the encouraging way? How can we encourage someone? Because there's enough things in our world that discourage us, are there not? There's enough things in our world that seek to tear us down. We are called to build each other up. Let's pray together. God, our hearts are so often distracted by our own hurts, our own fears, the things of our lives. And we so easily spew them out to others. God, help us. Help us to be people who are known by our words and by our actions, but who are known for our encouraging words. Help us, God, to build people up around us. And especially those that are hard to love, those enemies, those difficult ones. Help us, God, to stoke the fire that has gone out in their lives, because we have the fire of your Spirit in us. In Jesus' name we pray.